We keep making our home a little further along. And what is the secret to success? What is the ultimate secret? The ultimate secret of success is hindsight. Hindsight. And that's the last place anyone would look for it, right? It's actually hindsight. This is really getting to the nitty-gritty. How do you get hindsight? Of course, you have to practice. You have to work at it. There's no way around it. So the secret is actually hindsight. If people want to know, can you just tell me the secret? What hindsight is the secret? Because hindsight is 2020, and looking back, and you can see where you've been, the progress you've made. You can begin to recognize, you know, what works, and you get more and more poise because you have done the work. You have the hindsight to know. This is why I say a contemplative culture is a necessary, well, it is the culture that works. It is the culture that works. Is what we really want. Now, to flip the script even more here, so we can go as rapidly as possible, the Truther movement, which is talking about what's going on in the world, outing the whole you know, covert space program, the Illuminati, you know, what do we have to look forward to in the next 18 months in this world? The, you know, possible false flag, which is really the usage of by the Illuminati of the covert space program and the space ships that they have, actually put them over the skies of the world and the cities of the world as if an alien invasion is occurring, and then give that as an excuse to declare martial law in order to protect it, you know, have a global coordinated global response to the alien invasion. But it would be a fake alien invasion because we're using our own covert spacecraft that most people don't even know we have. That's what's called the false flag alien invasion. And then the, you know, the so that's one scenario. And so the people are, you know, everyone's working to avoid the reptoid draconian takeover of this planet, working through the Illuminati, also the depopulation agenda of the elites who feel that they want to depopulate the world, get rid of the people on this world, and then repopulate it with elite genetics. So there's all this stuff going on. And their answer, the Truther movement, the answer is to, you know, we say, hey, we can use all this technology and distribute it properly and be able to have a really strong economy, and with all this new, you know, super high tech that's being kept secret from us, we'll be able to do this and everybody be happy here and be able to have jobs and money and be able to go forward with cleaner technology, use the mantoid. There's a race of ETs, the mantoids, like they look, they call, they're sort of like cross between ants and praying mantises, but mantoid, who are very good at genetics and bioengineering, and we think if we just copy some of that, we can have this green planet. You know, this is where that comes from, the mantoid influence on our ideology at this time, with you know, saving the planet. We're able to go into super technical genetic engineering of engineering various bugs to do, you know, to do all this kind of stuff that will restore the planet to a pristine, beautiful place where I'll live, you know, in this new utopian paradise. And this is the ones who are supposedly the good guys saving us from the terrible reptoid Draco elitist Illuminati takeover, you know, and all this kind of stuff. So this is what's really percolating, and the next 18 months will be very intense as this goes forward. Supposedly there's a deadline for the Dracos to succeed, etc., etc. Now, what I realized, and it's been very clear, it just snapped into very clear focus. it's very funny. the real takeover is from the guy, the ones who are doing all the whistleblowing, who are saying, hey, we can have this technical, this green, high-tech utopia on this planet. That's the real danger, actually. Because that's what blocks contemplative society. And what I'm seeing is all these, the false flag is actually all of this talk about how the Illuminati and the elites are, you know, we have to protect against this because they're going to succeed and this is terrible. It's the boogeymen that they're saying, you know, we have to band together and we have to make this green tech, high-tech green utopia in this world, you know, to avoid this terrible takeover. And so we're so frightened of that, we get stampeded into accepting their agenda, which is really, in many ways, the worst agenda of all. The worst agenda of all. And so we take our eyes off the prize as we get caught up in this drama, like, oh my gosh, you know, we really need to do this, because if we don't, you know, the whole world's going to be depopulated. Well, it'll be World War III, and, you know, and so we all got to band together and get pulled into this ideology of super high-tech, super genetic engineering, super bugs, you know, remolding the world into a new economic structure that benefits everybody economically, and living a very happy, fulfilling life with more and more scientific investigation and da-da-da-da-da. That is the booby prize. That's the worst booby prize, actually. What we really want is a contemplative culture. That's what I'm about. I have zero interest in their utopian, you know, high-tech green utopian plans for planet Earth. This is what distracts us from truth, actually. So it's very interesting script how this is as they're protecting from one false flag, they themselves are another false flag. You know, it's a meta script of this duality, which is, this is a little play, a little dance here, designed to get us into this fourth dimensional structure, which is a very bad delaying structure, very bad. And so this is what I've been pointing out in my videos, one way or the other, saying the goal is spiritual enlightenment, actually, is singularity. Recognition, we don't have any structure, we don't have any needs. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. So it is a real, you talk about a psyop, it's more than we know, it's more than we know. The ones who are protecting against the psyops are also a bigger psyop, you know. Because what we really want is what works to free us from delusion. The delusion of time, space, process, and form. That's a dream, the delusion of this horrible dream where we think we have a need, that freedom, when we believe that freedom has a need for something specific, then actually what happens is we have this feeling of need, and then we see freedom as something which comes from that freedom needs this feeling of need first, and from that it's free. So in other words, bliss, we see that bliss comes from need, the feeling of need somehow, and that ultimately God comes from this feeling of need that we're having. We're placing ourselves as primary. This feeling of neediness is primary, and out of that all reality comes from that. So we're really trying to usurp the role of prime creator by doing this. And so we believe that if without this feeling of neediness, of need, that reality would cease to exist, because we think that this is primary, you see. So we're terrified to give it up. We think we'll be annihilated if we give it up. So we're desperate then to have some civilization, universe, bodies, etc., that keep this feeling of need going. And so we say, you know, what's the best way to keep this feeling of need going? Oh, if we have this high-tech green, this wonderful society, civilization, fourth dimensional, we can keep this feeling of need going and we won't be annihilated. You know, this is the delusion. This is a dream. It's this dream that we really want to get free of. And The kicker is, of course, we don't need to get free of it because we already are free of it. We already are freedom. So the trap that keeps us bound is the thinking that we need to get free of it, or that we need to be a teacher, or we need anything at all. No, we don't need. Reality is not based on needs. It's based on desire, or what we want to experience. So we can say, well, this experience has been very interesting, the experience of believing in need, and now I'm going to, I feel like I want to experience something else, and that's all. You have to recognize this. So even we don't even have a need of liberation. See, this is very key. And this is where we're living right now, okay? This is where our temporary home is familiarity with this, that we don't even need liberation. Because that is the trap, the subtle trap. And we don't even need, no one needs to be a teacher. No one needs to be a savior. Not at all. The fact that one is free from the delusion of needs automatically is a saving grace. It's a saving grace. But no one needs the saving grace. No one, there is no need for it. It is simply that we really want it. And so we are able to focus upon that. We're able to focus upon that. Those who have woken up from this dream of neediness, then automatically, if we really want that, we do, it benefits us because it helps us wake up. But we don't need to wake up because we're not really bound by it at all. It's just a want. The dream is just a want. We just wanted to experience this dream. So we're experiencing it. We don't need to experience the dream. So there isn't any actual need to experience the dream. Therefore, there's no need to get rid of a need. So you don't use need to get rid of need. As Jesus says, you can't make the illusion real and then get rid of it. That's the mistake we make. So enlightenment, it's not like you're a teacher then. You don't say, okay, I'm a teacher because I feel a need to teach. There is no need to teach. There is no need to do anything in particular. In order to be free to do whatever you want to do. See, we're already free to do whatever we want to do. And we're just choosing now to imagine that we're not free. But that's what we want to do. But we're now saying, no, you know, I really want to experience something else. And here's where the tricky situation comes in. We have this continuity fear. And so that continuity fear functions in a way where it seems like we're not free to do whatever we want to do. And so then, therefore, we conclude that this must be a need to do this, and not a want, not our free choice, but a need. And then we feel trapped. So at the bottom of success is recognizing the continuity fear. Once we confess, recognize, see we have a continuity fear, then we don't get trapped in this, oh, this is all a need, must be, I must need this experience. We say, no, I want it. I just want it. And the reason why I can't set it down for something else is it's not because it's a need, but because of this continuity fear. And then wisdom enters the situation and you make progress towards setting it down. You begin to evaporate this continuity fear. You begin to work at the level of familiarity. You begin to work on familiarity. Understanding that the level is just a figure of speech. There are no needs, so there are no level of needs. Since we're perfectly free, there isn't any level of want. I want to do this. No. All is equally smoothed out as far as our choice goes. We can choose any experience, any instant whatsoever. So this is what perfect freedom is. There's never an instant we will ever experience where we're not perfectly free to choose any experiencing that we want to choose out of the the endless potential of God. That's what we actually are. But you see, that doesn't mean that we're going to go crazy and choose all these different experiences that, you know, try to make ourselves seem chaotic. No, we don't have to do that. We're not bound to do that either. So we can just choose and experience this instant, which we're comfortable with. Say, I like this. I'm just going to stay with this for a while. I'm going to keep choosing this. That's fine. We don't have to become manic explorers of experiencing. No. You see, there's no need for us to do that either. But intrinsically, we're created to enjoy experiencing. So, but if we feel a little hesitant, you know, that's fine. Don't have to. There's no such thing as being left behind in reality. There's no purpose or goal to reality. You can't be left behind. So even, you know, we have this feeling like we've been in this dream of wanting to experience what we think is a need. Okay, but that's just a want, a choosing to this dream of need. For so long, for so many moments, instances, the experience has gotten so familiar to us. And then we realize there isn't any reality of need. And we think, oh my gosh, we've been left behind. We're so, because in this need, we develop this hierarchy of levels to try to experience it. And so we assume that reality is this purpose, this directional purpose that we're being driven towards some ever unfolding greater and greater and greater being or something. So we think we're way behind. This is not true. God is not some purpose-driven reality. God is not, as Jesus said, God is not an architect of universes. He's not some grand designer, grand architect. That is the dream of need that we're having. That's what arises within this dream of supposed need, wanting to experience something we call need, even though it's just, it's actually just a want. The whole thing's a want. There's that's why I say nothing's ever happened to me. There's never been any actual need whatsoever. It's always just been a wanting as if there were a need. It's an as if scenario that we've been experiencing. So we haven't been left behind. You cannot, there's no such situation as being left behind. Nobody can ever be left behind. That doesn't exist in reality at all. Everyone is, we're all still one perfect oneness with no such situation as someone being inferior or superior or being left behind, someone being more advanced or someone more retarded. None of that exists in reality. It's only in this dream of supposed need, of hypothetical need, that we have structured all of this idea of advancement and higher and lower and progress and growth and potential and evolution. And all of that is just a dream. It's a what-if scenario, which is really saying, what if we could be primary before God, before reality, and reality is based on something other than the prime creator. We call this the what-if scenario of need. And that does spin out into all these layers and levels and hierarchies and idea of progress. And, you know, when we have a dream, for instance, when we go to sleep and dream, what is it that's preventing us from dreaming anything we want to dream? So we could dream of evolution, for instance, the idea of progressing. We could have a dream where someone is gradually getting better and attaining skills and all this. It could be a fantasy. So this realm that we layers and levels and needs, it is a fantasy. And there's nothing preventing us from designing the fantasy any way we want to. But actually, because of the fear of setting it down, we end up structuring it, and it's become the way, the fantasy is the way that it is. But we can structure it, and there's some, you know, ways that we can play with it a little bit. But we've been playing with it for a lot of play with this, and it's taken on this basic format that makes it seem necessary. Like a need. This isn't like necessary. It's like a necessary dream. So we're dreaming a dream that the dream is necessary. We're having a dream in such a way, it says, oh no, this, there's a design to this, and there's a progress to this, and the God of the dream, yes, we're dreaming a God of the dream too, is a God of design and architect and purpose and progress, and therefore we have to be making, go through this dream as necessary for us to be what we are and to become what we need to become. All of that is the dream. It's a what if scenario. And so as we practice, we take into account this wow and the continuity fear, which arises from the wow. And we don't get trapped into believing that the continuity fear we have therefore means that all this is, the dream is real, or there's actual need present. There isn't any actual need present at all. But the continuity fear makes us feel like there probably is. It seems that way. So we identify the continuity fear and deal with it by full stop in the wow. It's like, wow, this is amazing information. But for sure, the continuity fear is going to get jittery about this. Say, well, what about all the needs? You know, what about my progress? What about me? If I drop this, I'm going to be left behind. You know, I'm going to go into a situation where I'm abandoned. Like that. I won't have any way to make progress. Or if I find out that none of this progress was necessary, then I will have missed out on all the progress that was necessary. And so I have to stay in this dream to catch up with all the progress that is necessary. You see, this is the freak out that continuity fear is all about. It's just very severe worry and concern and freak out. And so we have to recognize this, that we do have this dread, freak out dread of I'm going to be inferior. I'm not going to be able, I'm going to be way, way inferior, because we're so sure that reality is some situation of progress, and we find out this is all just a dream, that we've had a dream of progress, and they say, well, but then I haven't been making the real progress. So then we say, well, I got to restructure the dreams and make sure that I make the real progress. And this is what this green high-tech utopia is all about, fourth dimensional, is this freak out saying, whoa, we got to make sure we make the real progress. And so everyone's buying into this. Okay, this is the real progress. So once we make that, then we can set down the dream, because we'll be in sync with reality, the real progress that we've been unaware of because we've been dreaming. Listen to this. There's no such thing as progress in reality at all. So this dream of progress we've been having, which is just a delusion, doesn't set us back at all. It's impossible to be set back. There isn't any design or structure, architect of progress in reality whatsoever. So we don't have this imaginary need to catch up to the progress we've been missing because we've been dreaming. It's like, let's say we go to sleep and we have this dream of this vast odyssey of progress and development we're having. And then we start wake up and say, well, wait a minute, something feels weird as I'm waking up. Because what we're waking up to is this dream disappears and there isn't any notion whatsoever of progress once we wake up. And then we say, wait a minute, I better not wake up yet, because I can't recognize the progress as I'm waking up, I'm not in tune with the progress. I better go keep sleeping and figure out how to align with the progress so I can wake up. So we think that waking up has to do with aligning with the progress that we will experience once we wake up. Once we set the dream of progress down, we think we need to be aligned with the real progress. Otherwise, we'll be out of sync with reality. There isn't anything to sync up with in reality. There isn't any progress to sync up with. So, can full stop in the wow. This is very intense information. So we take a little time just to hang out with this. Because this, again, this should trigger a wow. It does in me for sure. And this is, we moved our base camp a little closer to the top, right? Moving our base camp a little closer to awakening. Oh, there's nothing that I need to sync up with. And also we're staggered by just how deceptive the dream is we think we need the dream of progress and we need to figure out how to sync up with the progress that we have been unaware of while we're dreaming. Where in fact there isn't any such progress to sync up with once we awaken. There's just the effortless allness of now, the effortless freedom, which is boundless glory without any need, notion of progress. Because how can we have progress in absolute freedom? That means that somehow there's a chain going. No, freedom is free to experience any experience it wants to, always. So there is no such design of progress. I shouldn't have just said that because we're already in the wow. And you know, don't need to keep restating it at this point. Gets a little too intense. So that was an example of a mistake there. So just which means a little more patience is required here. What happened was, I see how close this is. And so I tried to say, let me try a little more. Should have just stopped in the wow. So now we're just stopping this wow, full stop in the wow. Stop in the wow. Which means don't extrapolate success from this. It's already obvious how successful this recognition is. It's inherently obvious. The potency of this is inherently obvious. So we don't need to start extrapolating, planning, designing, extrapolating, thinking. It's what we do is just say, wow. This is great. Wow. That's all that needs to be said, actually. I mean, upon enlightenment, what do we need to say? Say, wow. This is great. Just that's it. Wow. I'm awake. Wow. So we need to train ourselves to this, towards this wow. This is called wowism. I'm awake. Wow. There are no needs. Wow. There are no needs. No design, no plan. No need for progress. No need to catch up. What do we need to think about plans? Why do we need to scheme plans? Come on, you know. Why do we need blueprints? Just, okay, I need to do this, I need to do that. No, just, so there's no, just wow. Wow. So, getting used to just resting in this wow is very important, very helpful. So we don't slip back into the dream of saying, oh gosh, I need to sync up with something. I'm missing. I'm not quite in sync yet with the progress, with the design of reality. We just say, just rest in the wow. That's it. And then we don't slip back into this dream of necessity, of progress, of design. Slip into thinking, my gosh, I'm so inferior. I don't recognize my progress. The I, you know, beginning of progress. Okay, the I says, okay, I'm incomplete without some progress. So I identify this, and that's progress. I'm adding to what I am. I'm becoming greater. So where's the I? Yeah, that's gone. Wow. Where's the design? Where's the need? Gone. Where's the progress? Where's the sinking? Where's the sync up? Gone. Nothing to sync up with. See, without the I, there's nothing to sync. So when we realize no self, there's nothing to sync up. And so we just say, wow. We don't go in search of it. Say, hey, wait a minute, where'd you go? I need to sync you up. I need to show that I, you know, reality, okay, this is the progress I've made, and so I need to now integrate this. There's nothing to integrate. Wow. So instead of searching, you just rest, full stop in the wow. Full stop in the enlightenment. But enlightenment is wow. It's that's how to so-called stabilize in not dreaming. Is wow. Culture is so off track. What's going on? This dance, this play of the bad guys and the good guys, and the good guys are protecting us from the bad guys, but the good guys in turn out to be even worse bad guys. Are just as bad, but actually worse, because we think they're the good guys. You know, there's no need for, we don't have a need for any of that. We don't need to sync anything up. So we don't need a design at all to sync up. We don't need a structure at all to sync up. We don't need a progress at all to sync up. So why do we need time, space, process, and form? We don't need it. Remember, to have a structure, it takes two, this and this, a chain, you know, a link, two links to make, start out a chain. So the I is just actually the beginning of the belief that we need something to sync up with reality, right? It's the beginning, but it's dualistic at the very beginning, because it's like the idea of complete completion has to have something that's incomplete that is now in the process of being completed. So the I is not separate. Some separate concept is actually a concept of progress, of time, space, process, and form. So you say all of this is the dream of I need. It's not I, it's I need. Who am, what is this I need? We say, well, who am I? What is this I need? Who is this I need? What is this I need-ness? Is the I need-ness needed? Does reality need I need-ness? Reality doesn't have any needs. And you can't say meaningfully that what is intrinsically created as reality had a need to be intrinsically created as reality. And you can say it, but then it's just, you know, meaningless, conceptually meaningless statement. And it's a belief that I need to sync up with, you know, that is so, this is still level confusion. Anyway. Just letting this wow, you know, marinate. Just marinate in this wow. I was talking yesterday, having a conversation about going to what's called Fan Fest. A lot of Major League Baseball teams have a Fan Fest. The Giants, San Francisco Giants, have a Fan Fest. You get to go on the field. You get to go in the dugouts, in the locker room, in the press box. You get access to all this stuff. It's really cool. So, getting out on the baseball field. Get on the baseball field. Get on the pitcher's mound. You get on the infield. And you look up at the stands and you look and it's like, this is what it's like to be a big league player. You're here out on this field, and you just say like, wow. It really is like this. It's just this. You just have this feeling like, wow. And so this is, you know, it's like, this is an example of just wow. And you say, this is just really cool. I just want to feel this wow. That's all. That's all I wanted to feel. I just want to feel, let me just feel this wow. And so when we're getting close to enlightenment, realizing the dream isn't needed. See, how do we set the dream down? How do we stay awake instead of going back into this dream? We realize the dream isn't needed. Don't need it. We don't need to sync up with ant. We've got ant invasions now. There it is. Every morning, I keep trying to block their way they get in. They come in. Terrible ant invasions. So you get into everything. There isn't any need to sync up. See, this is key. So, we're getting very close to realization here. It's like being on a big league field. And you get the feeling like, wow, if I wanted to play baseball for the Giants, for instance, this is how it would feel. I mean, this is the field I'd be on. You know, I just like, wow. And what do? Do you start talk? No. Get used to that feeling. Because in the case that we're talking about, we are going to be enlightened. We will be playing on that big field, so to speak. So we have to get used to this wow. It just has to feel like normal to us. So if I just went out on that field every day, took grounders, took fly balls, took practice, gradually I'd get used to it. You know, gradually I'd get used to it, and then I'd say, yeah, I can do this. Yeah, I'm used to it. But the first time you go out on that field, wow, I felt like this is overwhelming. The immaculateness of the dirt, the grass, everything that's there is just like, wow, this is big time. So enlightenment is big time. So as we recognize that we can awaken from the dream and stay awake, because we're seeing the dynamic that pulls us back into dreaming, and we realize we don't need that. So this is just like, you know, this is getting used to the big time where we're doing it. So this is like, wow, this is like fan fest. We're out on the field. and those who, you know, really want to be big time, that, you know, this is helpful, very helpful. You go, wow, I need to get used to this. You be honest, say, wow, I'm not quite used to this. You know, I thought I could walk out there and feel like, okay, I'm this is where I belong. But I felt like, whoa. I felt a little lightheaded. Just as, holy cow, this is great. This is really great. I'd really love to be out here. You know, it's like that. You're just so overwhelmed by just how cool it is. And furthermore, we're realizing that I can be out there. You know, I can be enlightened. Now, I see a deaf, of course, absolutely. Absolutely. So that's another big wow. Imagine if you walked out on that baseball field and someone said, hey, you know what, we want you to play for us. You know, we can see that you love the game, so we'd like to have you be part of the team. You know, what would you say? I would say, okay, wow, sure. But I need to sit in the dugout and just get used to it for a while. Don't expect me to go out on that field too much right away. It's like overwhelming. I'd say sure, absolutely. But that's realizing, hey, I have an adjustment period. You know, I have to get used to the what's present. And I know, you know, I'd be fine once the continuity fear, you know, familiarity sets in. I'd be fine once you settle down. You know, you'd be fine. Just like rookies, they get too nervous. It's overwhelming, and their talent doesn't come through. And so they, you know, they have to settle down. It takes a while for them to settle down. Maybe it takes several years for them to really settle in. There's a few rookies who come up and they're able to settle down right away. That's very unusual. The Giants have one right now, Joe Panic. He came up from Double A and he just settled right in and was a World Series star and just started. And it's like nothing gets to him. It's incredible, very unusual. But that's his personality. See, nothing seems to pull him out of the moment. You know, he's able to just stay within himself, within the moment. It doesn't let any stage get too big for him. That's very unusual. Probably he was a reincarnation of a baseball player in a previous life, probably a star, where he says, oh yeah, this is very normal to me. I'm used to it. I'm used to it. He has the look of a star, no question about it. And so I would say previous life, he was probably a baseball star. But for those of us who were not, Oh yeah, you get the jitters for sure. So this is obvious that the door to enlightenment is opening. It's open, and you just have to accept the obvious that yeah, we're gonna make it. Yeah, like that. Yeah, I'm gonna say I'm gonna make it. I see it for sure. So that brings up the jitters, doesn't it? It's easy for people who are not really, don't really want to go big time. They want to stay in the dream and keep trying to develop their potential so they can sync up with what they assume is the process, the development of reality. It's easy for them to be dilettantes. It's easy to be a dilettante. It's easy to watch baseball on TV, you know, and say, yeah, I could do that. Yeah, someday I can do that, yeah. It's a totally different story to be someone and say, you know what, I am going to do that. I am going to be big time. This brings up the jitters. So those who are really on the path, for sure, they're going to have the jitters. And that's why I say this wowism, this approach is so important. For those who are going big time, there needs to be a mentoring program that they realize what's going on. Because they run into a lot of problems. And the thing is the world is mostly completely dilettantish spiritually. We don't have a contemplative culture here, okay? So it causes extreme problems. Whereas in a contemplative culture, they have mentoring programs for all this. It's understood. And they recognize, okay, you're deciding to go big time. Great. Okay. Well, here's this mentor and this mentor and this mentor, and you go from one mentor to the next, and they help settle down the jitters. Here, we don't have any of that. It's all dilettantes here, which is all about how do we design a better world? How do we design a better future so that we can make enough progress so eventually we can sync up with reality? This is delusion. The more you try to progress to sync up with reality, the more deeply you're sleeping. Reality doesn't have any design to sync up with. None. Zero. So we lack a mentoring program in the West and mostly around the globe now. And as we go into this new fourth dimensional paradigm, which is a cooperative effort, it's cosmic corporate culture, which includes quite a few extraterrestrial groups actually. Some reptoid groups, some mantoid groups, some gray groups, Pleiadian groups, all various Nordics. There's a lot of different extraterrestrial cultures actually, and they have this collective corporate cult culture, which fourth dimensional culture, and this is what's at work here, designing this world to be a fourth dimensional planet. And of course they're at war with those who want to have this world be, you know, what they want to be, which is a place with elitist genetics, or various other dictatorships, like draconian dictatorship or something. So that's the struggle that's going on. Okay. But this is all deepening the sleep, deepening the dream, actually. It's not awakening at all. This is the opposite of awakening. This is not contemplative culture. So this is what's coming in this planet. And because the collapse into compliance is with this cosmic corporate culture, okay, which is a collective. See, the funny thing is that these extraterrestrial groups work together like a corporation. Let's say like a big corporation has many subcontractors, okay, and like the corporation, like a big air something that builds airplanes, or you know, they have this umbrella. There's this corporate is an umbrella, and they have under this umbrella they have many subcontractors who specialize in this system and this system manufacturing this. So these extraterrestrials have this corporate structure where they cooperate to produce culture and civilization, fourth dimensional culture and civilization. And they have they all have their specialties, and so the corporation, civilization, as a result of this collective cooperation, so I call it cosmic corporate culture, is what we're talking about. This fourth dimension, what we're entering into, is cosmic corporate culture, as is the third dimension. But the fourth is a more cooperative, bringing in more different extraterrestrial groups, and humans are now just going to be part of that cosmic corporate culture, one type of group, humanoid, and then you have all these other groups giving their specialty, like the mantoids have this, you know, genetic bioengineering specialty, you know, at various other, the reptoids have ritual and ceremony and that type of, and bureaucratic hierarchy type of specialties. And so there's all this different stuff comes in. The Pleiadians have this art and culture and beauty and that kind of stuff, you know, and different. So they bring in these different things, and the combination of all this produces culture, civilization and culture. Design, and so, but they design the future. They're constantly working on designing the future, planning the future, designing, structuring all this. This is the dream, and the more you buy into this, the deeper you're dreaming, the more difficult it is to awake from the dream. And stay awake. I mean, awakening from the dream means you stay awake. I mean, you can wake up for a moment and then go back to sleep. That's what happened to me in 1978. I did wake up from the dream, and then I went back to sleep. But I was conscious that I was going back to sleep. That was the difference. I was aware. I said, okay, now I'm slipping back into the dream. But I'm aware that I'm slipping back into the dream, and I'm going to take this awareness that this is a dream, and then I did awake, and I slipped back into a dreaming state, but I'm going to keep this awareness, and I'm going to work on now waking up from it permanently. And the Holy Spirit says, absolutely, you will do this. We will do it together. We will do this together. It's just a matter of working at it and dispelling the continuity fear of, like, oh, I'm afraid I'm not gonna be able to sync up with reality, you know. I gotta be real smart. I gotta have this very successful persona, this ego, this I gotta have this idea of completeness, of how do I complete. I need, as if reality is some massive effort to complete reality, and so waking up means, with reality means, getting into some sort of school, you know, of a job of completing reality. So I got to make sure the dream, I got to work on completing, working on being very good at learning and acquiring knowledge and study, so that when I wake up, I can get a job in reality. This is delusion. This is the heart of delusion. There isn't any job in reality. There isn't any project to complete reality. And so when we don't see this, we say, whoa, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do, whoa, you know, my gosh, I must have been abandoned, you know, or left alone, or I'm totally stupid, or what happened, you know, freak out. And so when I woke, I wasn't freaked out initially. I woke up and said, oh, I see the delusion, okay, I realize all this dream is a complete delusion. But the freak out was working to put me back to sleep. But I did. I also felt like, hey, this is great, this is wonderful. But there was also reactions of being overwhelmed and freaking out, which brought me back into the dream. You see, but I was conscious of this. Okay, this is what's happening. Okay, there's a continuity fear. I'm going back into sleep. Okay, but so there was some consciousness, awareness of what's going on. Went back into the dream, and that's why I was able to then start very, very, very intensely working on it. So I would say that a moment of awakening is necessary for someone to actually effectively work on awakening from this dream, instead of being a dilettante. So at some point, somehow, for a moment, you suddenly, you know, you moment you say, wow, I just had this moment of awakening. It can just be like an instant, actually. It'll happen very quick then. But you bring this awareness with you back into the dream. I say, hey, this is definitely a dream. This is all completely fake. This is not necessary at all. It's only a continuity problem that I'm struggling with. And then you it's like that, there's this heat that begins to evaporate the continuity fear, you know, the light of awareness begins to evaporate it. But as you do that, you get the jitters. As you evaporate your continuity fear, for sure you'll get the jitters. It's like being drafted out of high school by a major league team, and you sign a contract, and then you say, boy, I'm not ready for the big leagues. They said, no, that's right, so we're starting you a developmental league. You know, okay. And then you start getting better, and you say, whoa, I'm starting to improve. I might get a promotion. You get kind of nervous, say, wow. And then they promote you to low A ball or something or like that. And you say, wow, that's a one step closer to the big leagues. And then gradually you're promoted to, you know, single A, and then maybe then double A, then low triple A ball or whatever. You know, there's a lot of different levels they have. They can bounce you around in your development. But each step you take, you realize I'm getting closer to the big leagues, big time. And so this puts pressure on you and jitters. A lot of people who are drafted, they never make it because the idea of making it is so scarier to them. They plateau and they don't want to go any further. They say, I don't think I can handle the pressure of the big leagues. It's too much for me. So sometimes their development goes slowly, and sometimes it takes them quite a long time, maybe 10 years of development before they feel they're ready. And then when they come, they realize you're ready because the pressure doesn't get to them. They say, I'm ready. This is not too big for me. It's not, the stage is not too big. So how you go through that development depends. Now, if you've had a previous lives where we've made a lot of progress and didn't quite finish, then you'll go through very quickly and you may be ready very quickly. Whereas if that's not the case, you probably will have slower development. It'll take you a while. And this is my case. It's taken me a while to keep, you know, to get develop, get ready with the jitters, you know, jitters, wow, big time. I'm getting closer to the big time. Wow, this is a little scary. See, that you realize too that the fright is bogus, because there isn't anything you need to think of. There's no job. There isn't like, wow, now I have a very responsible job with completing, needing to complete reality, and I've got to teach all these students to help that's part of a completing reality. None of that is true. None of that is true at all. You realize there is no job. There is nothing to sync up with. There isn't any need to complete anything. I don't need to be a teacher to help all these people, soul spirits progress in order to sync up with something. There's no pressure at all like that. So being enlightened isn't pressure at all. It's the freedom from any pressure, actually. This I don't need to do anything. And this I don't need to do anything is the teaching. It's this complete unconcern that is the teaching. Who are some of the greatest teachers that recent times that we have, you know, a lot of information and visuals and all that? Ramana Maharshi, absolutely. Sri Sri Ananda Mahima, for sure. What was their characteristic? Total unconcern. Everything's perfect. I have no concerns at all. No concerns at all. Utterly carefree. Totally carefree. They're not some harassed person like, oh my God, now I've got this mega responsibility. I've made vice president in this hierarchy of reality. Now I gotta like, you know, have this extreme, you know, need to manage, micromanage everything and do all this stuff. And there's no burden at all like that. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi micromanaged in a way to help bring about support the culture of contemplation, the contemplative culture. She did all sorts of stuff to help, you know, help in that way. But never was there any sense of being burdened, a sense of burdened or concern at all. Which is why people are saying, well, that's amazing. It was amazing, yeah. But this is what it is. No sense of concern or burden or need or anything needs to happen like that. No, just saying pragmatically, this is what's helpful. This can be helpful pragmatically. But you don't need to awaken from this dream. But if you want to pragmatically, this is what is helpful. So it's not like there's failure can happen. So there's no such thing as failure in reality. Failure can't happen. That's why she always said, everything is perfect. Look, everything is absolutely perfect. Don't be so concerned. Failure is impossible. There's no such thing. It's not like, well, we can keep trying. We get to keep trying until we finally succeed. So we can keep having bodies and karma and working in this dream until we finally succeed. No, that's not what they're saying. They're saying no. Failure is impossible. It doesn't exist. There's no such thing as failure at all. Not that you can have unlimited time to succeed. That's not what they're saying. That you don't need any time at all. You don't need to succeed. There's no such thing as success. Since there's no such thing as success, how can there be such thing as a failure? you're perfectly free forever. You are eternal life right now. All is eternal life right now. Always. It can't be otherwise. So, success or failure, that's duality. There's no such duality with reality at all. Since there's nothing you need to succeed at, how can there be any failure? Alright? So, we're getting familiar with this. This is big time. Now, these teachers were big time. Okay, those two teachers I just mentioned. And now Jesus, coming on strong with A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, big time, okay, really big time. So we're getting used to these big, you know, big time perspectives. That's what I've done, and these videos reflect that. This is getting used to the big time. See, intellect is fine. Use it as reason. Very helpful. But you have to also balance that with this wow. See, the intellect is not syncing up with anything, really, right? Gotta be careful that the intellect doesn't turn into another syncing up project. Of progress. Gotta be very careful about that. This is what Radical Dzogchen points out. We're pointing out the same principle here in different terminology. This is why I got a teacher like Longchenpa, who's also big time. Okay? These teachers are very much big time. This perspective is very helpful. It's been very helpful. Because there isn't anything to sync up with. So we have to be careful that the path doesn't become an exercise in syncing up. Okay. This is why these teachers are very helpful, these big time teachers, is they keep you going and realize, oh, wait a minute. It's not about intellectual syncing up either. It's not about my spiritual path syncs up with the grand path of reality. It is not that at all. It's that there is no path to sync up with. So, a path, a conceptual path, is, we can say that there is no path. We don't need any such concept of a path. We don't have to look at what we've done as a path, actually. There isn't anything to sync up with. And so, the radical Dzogchen is to recognize this. However, in order to get to this recognition, there has to be a lot of development in terms of this wow, of realizing, smoothing it out, so that you do practice this full stop in the wow and get used to this. That, hey, this is that, seeing that there's nothing to sync up with, that's big time, but it takes quite a bit of moving your familiarity before you can actually recognize it and stay in recognition of this, you know, stay awake. So, in our continuity fear, we part of us always is thinking that we're making progress to sync up with reality. We're working to get into a good job in reality, so to speak, to help reality out. And as we go along, more and more we realize, wait, that isn't it. And every time we realize that's not it, there's nothing to sync with, that produces structural continuity fear. Whoa, what's my function then? What's my function? Oh, no function. Or we say, oh, a lot less than I realize. I get this feeling, maybe I don't have any that type of function. And that frightens us. So that seems like a path. Well, it is a path of evaporating our continuity fear. Now, the way that we're able to let go of the dream is to realize we don't need to view what we did as any sort of sync up at all. There's nothing to sync up with. And therefore, we don't need to see our past. We don't need to see the dream anymore. We don't really need to see it, because in seeing it and looking at it, trying to remember it, it will seem as though we've done all this stuff in order to make progress and build a resume. We don't need to see our resume anymore. We don't need a resume. So, of course, because of our continuity fear, we will believe we're working on a resume. But at the same time, we're also coming to realize we don't need a resume. And this is the dichotomy, which is why I say full stop in the wow is the way to do it. You make breakthroughs and you say, instead of saying, adding this to your resume, immediately just go into, no, this is just helping me evaporate the continuity fear and recognize I don't need a resume, and this is going to produce a wow. And so then full stop in that wow, instead of saying, great, I just added to my resume, now how can I convince reality that this part of the resume is important? And that's when you start spinning, and you realize, oh, I'm starting to spin this, and stop, whoa, no, full stop in the wow, I don't need a resume. So I say phase four, radical Dzogchen, phase four, full stop in the wild, is realizing you don't need any resume, including the resume of intellectual structure, of conceptually thinking that you don't need a resume, including that, especially including that, which is why it's so important at phase four to just go into this wow, more and more into this wow. Stop. Sure, we're still looking at this verbally, conceptually, and are also then just, wow. Yeah. I don't need to convince reality of everything. I don't need a radical Dzogchen resume either. You see, this is very crucial. don't need a Sri Sri Anandamayi resume either. I don't need a Ramana Maharshi resume either. I don't need a Jesus Christ resume. I don't need a Course in Miracles resume. I don't need. Needing a resume is still need. No resume is needed. Nor is a resume not needed. You see, it's the whole thing about need and not need. It's just wow. I am free. I'm completely free. Always have been free. What resume does freedom need? This is the question we should need to hold in mind. What resume does freedom need? Absolute perfect freedom, always and forever. To play with, to experience any potentiality, experience any potentiality whatsoever, any instant, all is available, always. What resume does that need? What resume does that need? And again, instead of pursuing this, the question brings the inherent wow, doesn't it? The very fact of raising this question brings this wow with it. It's obvious what the question is pointing to. What resume does absolute freedom need? Does it need a resume? And of course, instead of, this is an appeal to the wow. You see, this is what we're doing with these videos. Appealing to this wow, just full stop in the wow. Just obviously, self-evident, wow. Don't say, yeah, this is familiar to the teaching of this teacher, and I'm interested in how you expressed it and how this other teacher expressed it. Now, I wonder if this teacher, you know, how pure their teaching. See, as soon as you start doing that, jumping right back into structure and resume. That's why we say full stop in the wow, working on full stop, which is difficult. We're not trying to perfect a full stop in the wow, because that too is part of trying to build a resume. So what we're doing is we do the best we can and just get used to it enough where we're at now, which is getting very close to big time, you know, very near big time. Get used to it, let the familiarity set in, and then by doing that, we'll be able to push even further, which again will struggle with full stop in the wow. So don't try to build your resume on trying to perfect full stop in the wow, because that means you're not really pushing even further, closer. You know, if you say, wait a minute, let me stop right here, let me see if I can become a master at full stop in the wow. That's resume building. That is resume building, big time. again is another wow, isn't it? I go, wow. Not even that do I need. Wow. I don't even need to be an expert at full stop in the wow. I don't even need that on my resume. I don't even know what to title these videos because there's so much great information here. You know, how can I even say it? You know, hopefully, those who are watching, hopefully they're recognizing this. It's just like, you know, can't really explain it in just a simple title of video. But it's up to the Holy Spirit, you know, who watches and who doesn't. That's not my problem. Again, I'm not building a resume of videos or people watching videos or anything like that either. There's no resume there either. So this wow that is built up in this video is very intense now. Now, again, we've got to be careful. Don't try to dissipate it through sneezing or any which way. Just sitting quietly. Coughing, sneezing, scratching, getting up, moving around. All of that is an attempt to dissipate this wow. What we're doing is mentally, we're trying to just stay in the wow through our spiritual will and clarity and attention. And hold the intensity. Don't try to dissipate it. We're trying to get used to the intensity, not trying to dissipate it. See, that's why I say full stop in the wow means get familiar with the big timeness of this. This is really big time. And I can say that because a lifetime of studying the spiritual path, spiritual teachers, hindsight and doing the path, you know, all of this stuff. You know, I can tell this is big time where we're at right now. Very, very much so. And so this is intense. Try to hold the intensity. And the best way is just keep sitting still. If sneezing, all this stuff starts saying, no, I'm not going to dissipate this intensity. And use your will. Say, this is life and death. I am not going to succumb to this. I am going to stay with this. Doesn't matter. No matter what, I am going to stay with this intensity. And you have to, like, fight for it, you know, really dig in and hold on as if it's a life raft. Imagine like you're in this ocean, stormy ocean, and you have a life raft. And the waves are trying to knock you off the life raft. And you got to mean business and say, hey, I am not going to be pulled off this life raft for any reason whatsoever. And nothing will prevail against me. I'm going to keep this life raft. The wow is like, the intensity of this wow is like a life raft. And this is the intensity that's needed. I will not be separated from this life raft. Remember, don't be embarrassed or ashamed, like you're struggling. Struggling? Well, you can't, this is big time. Of course, the struggle is a badge of honor here. I mean, that means you're willing to take on tremendous big time intensity. See, in a contemplative culture, this is understood. Whereas in the culture we have now, they try to shame and stigmatize and say you should be having fun. You should be like, oh, I can't sneeze. What are you doing? Come on, go out, go ahead and sneeze. That's okay. Go ahead and have fun. Enjoy this new utopia we're building here. Well, that's what it's for, you know. This is what makes it tough. They don't understand at all. They think, what do you mean? You've been doing this for so long and you still should be easy for you. What's the problem? They don't recognize the developmental. In other words, you're getting closer and closer to the big time of realization. They don't even know what that is. So they'd have no way of evaluating it at all. And since they don't have any way of evaluating it and thinking that they build up a resume, they assume, well, then there's nothing there of value at all. The only value there is intrinsic, the value of absolute freedom, of what is. And since that's all there is, there's no need to even speak of it, conceptualize it as a value. But since we are in conceptual talking, you know, used to that, we can say, you know, we can use the term, as long as we don't get confused here. But it's incomprehensible to this materialistic, fourth-dimensional culture, corporate culture. It's incomprehensible to them that, you know, you would be working on sitting quietly like this for so long. That's crazy, they say. There's so many things to explore in this universe, you know. What are you doing sitting quietly like this? Well, I'm accepting the fact there is no universe. And they say, what are you talking about? We have to use the universe to develop and grow and learn and reach our full potential. And you know, this is the dream. Actually, this is the dream you have to awaken from. That's what I'm saying. And so, the sitting quietly means I'm making great progress. If I wasn't making great progress, I wouldn't be doing this. So, sitting quietly like this is generally, I mean, if you want to just be a dilettante and fake it for a while and be a poser, okay, fine. But generally, this is a sign you're making tremendous progress because you need to sit quietly because the wow is so intense. This is how you handle it. This is how you contain it. This is how you get used to it. It's like a rookie gets brought up in the big leagues, and maybe they just sit him in the dugout for a year. So they don't play much. And other people say, well, that guy must be a terrible player. He's not even playing. How ridiculous. I can go out and play, you know, in the park anytime I want to. This is stupid. Guy must be an NBA, you know, an idiot. He's not even playing. Now, the rookie may be very talented, but they're just getting used to it. They're bringing him along slowly. They can get used to the big time. So the problem in the culture we have now, this cosmic corporate culture, you have knuckleheads doing all the evaluating and setting standards for everyone. Total knuckleheads. Total dreamers. Severe dreamers setting the standards for culture and society. This is why it's a disaster what's taking place here. I mean, whatever happens in the future, to me, it looks like a disaster here. You know, whether the elites with their DNA hidden in various places off this planet or in underground, deep underground, whether they succeed in their plans, whether the draconians succeed in instituting their hierarchical structure on this planet. Or, you know, whether the fourth dimensional utopians succeed in their plan. They're all severe dreamers, all of them. All of them severe dreamers. So, I mean, what kind of choice is that, you know? It's like a car that doesn't run. You know, it's sitting in a car lot, and you go in this car lot, and they say, okay, you know, what color do you want of the car? You know, I got this red, yellow, green color, you know, and this is your choice. I say, yeah, but the car doesn't work. There's no engine in it. It doesn't work. What do you mean? What kind of choice is that? I say, no, this is your choice, you know. And so everyone's these salespeople or boosters of these different colors of cars. And it's the same car. It's the car of going into deep, deep coma like dream. And they're saying, yeah, but there's a big difference between what color of the car. It is a huge difference, folks. There's no difference at all. There's no meaningful difference at all about what these salespeople are talking about here. So whether the Illuminati went out or the fourth dimensional green utopians went, you know, tech utopians went out, the green tech utopians went out, what cosmic corporate culture really, whether they went out or the Illuminati wins out, it's just into what color car do you want? What color do you want your coma to be? Is what it really is. What color do you want your coma to be? Thanks, but no thanks, folks. And then you start leaving the lab. They say, what are you doing? You'll be nothing. You're choosing to be separate from everyone, from the everything. They lay this intense guilt trip on you when you're walking off the car lot, right? Please reconsider. You're choosing to be in opposition to all that is. You're choosing to be, you know, you're going to be left behind. You're choosing to be left behind, therefore separate from this great work of completion we're doing. What are you doing walking off the car lot, you know? They hit you with this intense guilt then. I've experienced that, absolutely. That's really tough. That's when Ramana Maharshi helped me, actually. Because I got hit with such an intense guilt trip by those who were selling resumes, you know, even resumes of A Course in Miracles, actually. And which is where it came from. Someone was selling resumes of A Course in Miracles. Hey, you can't walk off this car lot. You can't do that. You're going to damn yourself. You're going to be separate, you know, an intense guilt trip. And I said, no, I don't even need the resume of A Course in Miracles. And that was too much for him, you know. I said, no. And that's when I got very despondent, you know, and felt, wow, I'm not going to ever get anywhere in this world. And that's when Ramana Maharshi helped me out, showed up and told me, don't give up. You're going to make it. You're going to make the big time. You're going to make it. Just don't give up. Don't worry about all this stuff. So I believed him, you know. Because I knew he wasn't lying. He was telling me the truth. You know, there's no reason for him to say what he said unless it was true. So I just believed him. And then I said, okay, I'm not going to give up. And that's it. And from that point, I was able to, you know, move forward very quickly. Because the big timers want us all to be big time. In fact, they know we are big time, really. And we just are dreaming that we're not. And we will awaken from the dream because we don't really want it. That's why. Not because we need to, but because we don't want it. Intrinsically. We don't want to. We're attracted to the glory of our freedom. And we don't want to keep pretending we're not free. That's intrinsically so. We don't want it. So we don't need to set it down, but we really want to set it down. So, of course, we're all going to be big time. Recognize that we are. And so those who are big time, they know that. And so they tell us, yeah, you're going to make it. You're going to make it. And they want us to make it because they know we want to make it also. But what I found is what I've said in this video, I'll restate it. When you begin to set down even the high resumes, those who, what happens is, to make it simple, a guilt trip gets laid upon you. Like, you can't set down A Course in Miracles. That's resume is legit. You can't set down Radical's Oxygen. That resume is legit, you see. You can't do that. If you do that, you won't be able to sync up with the great grand resume in, you know, in the sky, so to speak. You won't be able to, you need the resume of pure spaciousness to sync up with pure spaciousness. And see, but they're stuck there. Those who are stuck there, they get panicky. Say, wait a minute, you can't do that. Because they feel they can't do it. It threatens their resume. And they're gonna say, oh my God, you're gonna have a greater resume than me. And I want to have the greatest resume because I need the greatest resume in order to sync up with reality. This is being stuck. There isn't anything to sync up with. There isn't any greater in reality. So you get those who want to be teachers of resumes, whether it's A Course in Miracles or Radical Sockchain or whatever, who feel very threatened if anyone is setting that down too. They say, no, you need to go through me, the teacher. I'll teach you. I'll tell you when you've got the resume right. This is what happens. So like a Longchenpa shows up to help you drop the resume of Radical Dzogchen, actually. Not to get the resume, but to realize you don't need the resume. That's why the teachers show up. Jesus shows up to help us realize we don't need the resume of A Course in Miracles. As he said, the whole purpose of the Course is to make itself unnecessary. But you don't need anything. But what is very effective is to be aware of this. The best teachings are the ones that help you drop all resumes, including the teaching that you're going through. You don't even need the resume of not needing a resume, so to speak. And that's, you know, that's just, this, you can do endlessly talk about this like this, but we have to recognize the wow here, the wow factor here. And we don't need to name names or crucify anyone. This is part of the trouble of this dreaming, is we do get stuck at times in trying to build a resume and thinking, okay, I'm a great teacher, for example, of A Course in Miracles, and everybody needs to listen to me. Why? Because I need to build my resume, and I won't be able to sync up with reality until I feel that I'm a great teacher, and I can't feel like I'm a great teacher of truth unless everybody syncs up with me and sees me as this great, great teacher. So I need everybody to recognize that I'm this great teacher in, you know, A Course in Miracles or something. And you get stuck in that. There's a very severe trap. But it's a trap potentially that we could all get stuck into. And to some extent we all do, some more than others. So we're not trying to crucify or vilify anybody here. We're just trying to help. by not getting stuck in that trap. How else can you help? The only way you can help is don't get stuck in that trap. There are many who have got stuck in that trap. Now, there's some who recognize that. There's a teacher recently who said he was big time, that he was it. And eventually there's so much flack back, you know, about this, and he eventually said that I succumbed to some egoic trap, you know, and I'm taking a step back from being a teacher. This is very unusual for someone to do that. This is to be applauded for sure. Yeah, of course, people are skeptical about it, and rightly so. But it can be done. Now, the trap is that even the teacher would build that stepping back as part of a resume to step forward again, you know. That's potentially, of course, a trap too. So basically, you know, that so-called teacher who has a lot of work to do still, but that teacher was helped out by those who are saying, hey, you know, no, I don't really feel like this is going to be, I don't need this as a resume. And people are saying, going beyond it, you know, helps those who get trapped in that. And there's certain types who do get trapped into that. And so many of the teachers that this world has seen is actually just those who are getting who got trapped in this desperate attempt to build a resume as a great teacher so that they could then sync up with what they believe reality must be like. You see, there's some great hierarchy of needing to work on completion. And they felt they couldn't sync up with it unless they were seen as a great teacher. So a lot of teachers throughout history have been like that, actually. Yeah, they're not really teachers. They were not real teachers at all. They had gotten stuck in that. And of course, that continues on. It'll always continue on. This dream to always have those who arise and make these claims. Some even claim, I am Jesus Christ, you know. As if they're actually this, you know, historic Jesus Christ or something. We are all Jesus Christ. That's a better profession. I mean, you don't say, I am Jesus Christ. So we are all Jesus Christ, actually. And there is no quote-unquote Jesus Christ. To go even beyond that, meaning there isn't any necessity to claim any resume of saying, I am Jesus Christ, right? But that too is but true. But we can say, we are Jesus Christ, of course, which is pointing to the realization that we're absolutely free. But there are those who, quite a few in the world, say, I am Jesus Christ. You know, I am the historical Jesus Christ. I am Jesus. This is, you know, this is me. Here I am, folks. You need to sync up with me. And, you know, this is it. You get people coming out of the woodwork. This is said in the end times, you'll get people coming out of the woodwork saying, you know, yeah, here I am. I'm Jesus Christ, or I'm this great teacher. I'm this and I'm that. Because they're getting desperate. They say, I need to sync up with reality. This dream as we know it, Pent is being restructured, is fourth dimensional. They'll say, well, I need to sync up with reality. My God, I need to awaken from this dream. I need to sync up. And so they say, I need everybody to recognize me that I am this great teacher so that I can sync up with reality. This is what's happening now. And more and more and more, this will take place. It's been taking place over the last 50 years ferociously. You get these teachers popping up saying, here I am, I'm God, this is what you need to sync up with. So they can have their resume of saying, okay, I'm God, therefore I can sync up with God, because I have this resume of everybody saying that I'm God, you know. And there isn't anything to sync up with. God doesn't even need the resume of being God. We don't even need the resume of being God, actually. So that's how you get free of those teachers, isn't it? And I don't need to name names, because if you've been part of the spiritual scene, part of the spiritual path, you know, and going forward, when you are, you will recognize this. Desperate need to get, you know, people need your email. I need you to sync up. I need you. I have to come on. This has got to sync up. Everything's got to sync up here. Whereas, like, for instance, Sri Sri Anandamayi here, Raman Maharshi, for example. Whoever wants to come, let them come. Whoever wants to leave, let them leave. I have no preferences. All is perfect just as it is. Not a trace of any neediness of I need to sink. I need to have a resume as a spiritual teacher. I need to say I'm God. I need to say this. I don't have any needs. Just I am. All is. All is. All is already free. All is already free. So whatever happens, that doesn't affect the freedom that already is in the slightest bit. And of course, people in the world right now will want to sync up. So they're looking to sync up with some teacher so they can have a resume. They're looking for a fourth dimensional resume, though. They're trying to get into a high position, fourth dimension. So I say, so I have a prominent role in helping bring this to completion so that then I can sync up with the greater completion of reality, with what they dream is endless projects of completion that I need to get into this fourth dimension to sync up with the fifth, to sync up with the sixth, to sync up with these endless dimensions, which are all even grander projects of completion. You know, this is all a dream. No sync is needed. There is nothing to sync up with. There is no grand project. There's no project at all in reality. Reality is not a project. None whatsoever. There's no projects. There's no need for any projects. We do have this. We want to experience. We really want to be experiencing reality as it is, and we actually are, but we don't. We're not aware of it. But so we really want to evaporate the continuity fear. Therefore, we really want what's effective in helping us do that. So pragmatically, if you want to conceptualize it and say, well, this is some kind of project or something, but we know what we're talking about. We have this continuity fear. So recognizing this, we don't get trapped in level confusion. You see, don't get trapped. Don't get trapped. Otherwise, these teachers who insist you have to sync up with them, or you insisting you have to sync up with this teacher in order to build a resume, you'll get trapped into it. Through level confusion, they'll use level confusion will be used to make you feel that you have to do this. But if you recognize, no, I just have a very severe continuity problem. That's my only problem. I don't need to sync up with anything. I just need to evaporate this continuity fear. Then you're not going to get trapped that way. And so you'll save yourself enormous time and suffering. But even when you do try to sync up, eventually you'll realize that getting free of this is what you really want. And you'll have some hindsight, you know, hopefully lesson learned and some hindsight, hopefully. At some point, for sure, yeah. It just depends how what the delay factor is there. And it's a dance. I mean, you have all these devotees here desperate to sync up with God or the teacher. And then you have someone who's desperate to build a sufficient resume to sync up with reality. So they're desperate to be seen as a great teacher. They'll come into the world and they'll find each other. And this mutual, you know, dance of syncing up, each one building their resume, spiritual resume, by doing so. So it's not a question of who to blame, it's a question of going past, saying it's not needed. Don't need a resume. And this brings the wow factor in. So this is why I say, effectively full stop, and the wow is so effective. When you say, I don't need a resume, that is wow. I don't even need this teacher. I don't even need to be a devotee. Or teacher doesn't need me as a devotee, actually. Wow. Then you realize delay is shrinking, right? Because you're not going to waste your time in all these various ways. That's why I say it's such a wow. You see, you know, this just saved me, you know, an incredible amount of wasted delay. Wow. I'm really getting closer to the real big time. The real big time. So we'll take a little bit of time now for this while, because it's more potent than we realize. This is very important to realize, is that our success is more than we realize, actually. Don't try to quantify it. Just, it's enough to say it's more than I realize. And then just say, okay, so let me be patient here. Let me not expect immediate results, because my sneeze was trying to build up wisdom. Cling to that life raft. Don't dissipate the intensity. There. So the focus is, don't dissipate the intensity. It's more than we realize. No question. This has just been an incredible video. Not incredible, amazing. I don't like the word incredible. I mean, it's not credible. It's very credible. This has been a super credible video. Let's put it that way. This has been a super credible video, and it's so credible that it's shocking. You know, it's true. This information is super credible, actually. Not incredible, it's super credible. And we're not used to that which is so super credible. But we can get used to it. See, we can get used to it. It's only familiarity. We can get used to it. So hold the intensity. It's like getting out on that baseball mound. Just stay out of that mound. Don't say, well, okay, let me go get some hot dogs, you know. No, say, no, I'm just going to stand here for as long as I can and just get used to it. Let the jitter subside. And after having done that, you come off the mound and say, and then next time you go in, you say, wow, I feel a lot less jittery. So don't break away for peanuts and popcorn, hot dogs, beer, whatever. Don't break away. Let's keep the intensity here. Super credible information here. Super credible. Now, all that whistleblower stuff, you know, some of the stuff they're saying is true. Some is, they're spinning in certain ways. They have agendas. So it's not, you know, it's a mishmash. So you say, well, there's some credibility to this. Okay, fine. But here, what I've experienced in making this video is super credibility about this dynamic, you know, we've talked about here. This information is super credible, and we're not used to that. I'm not even used to it, you know. I'm getting more used to it, but this video, this shakes me up too. Because I'm recognizing and saying, wow, this is super credible. This clarification is super credible. I've never gone into this territory before, like this before, this far. No, I have not. No. We're getting into more and more credible information here. Maybe I'll make the video title Moving into Super Credibility right now. Wow. Chilly winter day, beautiful sunny day in California, but we don't need the sun, we need the rain. So we're just holding this intensity, that's all we're doing. Don't break away from it. We're not trying to leap into anything else right now. We're just trying to hold on to this intensity. intensity of super credibility. I'm moving into the intensity of super credibility right now.
Wow.
And it's a fact. This is fact. Cough is starting to rise. This is what happens when you really make progress like this. Something will tend to arise to try and dissipate it and distract you from it. And my throat was suddenly gripped with this intense urge to cough and start going into some uncontrollable coughing. This has happened to me now maybe 3 or 4 times after particularly intense videos like this with super credibility. Spring is around the corner here in California. I mean, we start getting growth of greenery and mustard greens, and I mean, we're moving. We're moving towards it already. We're already moving. This is what, the third day of January. I mean, spring starts, lots of signs of spring are in February. And we start seeing early signs here in January, then it's February, then full blast in March. Now, people might call these attacks or something's attack. No. It's what's happening is, well, I don't need to say now because I'm still focusing on holding the intensity of wow. So let's not even talk about that. That's a whole different issue. It's pretty self-evident what it is, at least to me. Because of course, if I don't hold this intensity, I'm going to go back into vulnerability to resume building, right? Absolutely. What the coughing is trying to say, saying you can't hold this intensity. You shouldn't be holding this intensity. Let me help you dissipate this intensity. Which is really saying, you know, you need to sync up with reality. Let me help you sync up with reality. So instead of laughing, we end up in this uncontrollable coughing. The spasming of the trachea and stuff is like, I can't breathe. You know? So what I said is like a life raft. I said, no, I'm holding on to this intensity of this wow, no matter what. This is too important to let go. This is my feeling. For no circumstance am I letting this go. Full stop on the well means I'm not trying to entertain more progress at this point until I feel like this intensity is, I'm used to it. So various avenues of advancement are occurring to me, and I say no, not now, maybe later we'll look at that. It's more important to get used to, hey, I can contain this intensity. This advancement coming in is trying to distract me away from getting familiar with, hey, I'm okay with this intensity right now. I don't need any resume at all. I don't need any sync at all. Getting used to that is way more important than trying to run ahead right at this moment and make more clarifications and more advanced clarifications. No. Once you've maxed out on the wow, then hold the intensity of that wow and get used to it. Let it be for the day, You don't need to, and if you feel that it's okay to go ahead and be careful, but you can, but it's be very careful. It's more important to realize, I can live with this intensity. I can live with this realization. I can live with this big timeness. I can get comfortable. I can get familiar with it. Because this is a really big deal. So I said, well, not now, maybe later. Not now, maybe later. So we talk, we look, we examine, we inquire, we focus our attention to the point we build up we build up as much intensity as we can handle. So now let us just get used to it. This is the way. This is the way. You spend a block of time gradually building up more wow. And then it's okay, that's as much as we can handle. Now let's work on not dissipating this intensity. Do not dissipate the intensity. This is why contemplating culture has these various suggestions to don't dissipate the intensity. Can't be a party animal, you see. That dissipates the intensity. So after they've done their prayers, they walk quietly, do a little gardening or a little whatever they do. Basic maintenance and they're staying quiet and getting used to intensity, the big timeness, the getting used to big timeness. Dissipate the intensity, distract, dissipate the intensity. Don't eat too much. You don't overdo anything. You know, sort of a middle path. You know, just don't. If you know, in terms of Throw yourself into wild asceticism. I mean, the term middle path really came out of Buddhism, where there was a lot of extreme asceticism, stuff that to us would just be astonishing. So the middle path doesn't mean everything in moderation. It doesn't mean, oh yeah, I'm gonna go to like party tonight. I'll just party for like 2 hours instead of four. Or like, I'll use these drugs, but I won't use so many. You know, that's not what it's talking about. It had to do with don't throw yourself into this extreme asceticism. But asceticism is great. Buddhism's not saying asceticism is wrong. The point was, don't throw yourself into extreme asceticism. But certainly, contemplative culture was what they were all about, was what Buddhism was all about from the beginning, contemplative culture. It just don't go to extremes, because the violence of that extremism itself disrupts the getting familiar with the wow. If you're starving yourself, that hunger, and you know, it's going to be a distraction. So just eat a little bit of food. Don't eat a lot. Don't overindulge. That ascetics still eat food, but you know, don't overdo it. So that's the context of the middle path, and we're so far divorced from the experiencings of those times where the asceticism was just, I mean, we see a little bit of its vestiges of it still in the East and India and various places. And we, when we see it, we just say, my God, you know, that's just like bizarre. And that this stuff is tame. This stuff is tame. You know, you see the yogi, you know, holding their arm up like this. And they've been holding their arm up without ever bringing it down for like 10 years. Or standing on one leg for 10 years. Or not moving for 10 years, or whatever. I mean, you can dream up endless ascetic practices, and that's what used to be happening in a large scale among many, many people in that area. Holding a posture, yeah, for 10 years straight without moving. Rolling on the ground, wherever you go. Never standing, but rolling everywhere. For 10 years. On and on and on. If we could be transplanted back to that time and just be walking through the countryside and coming, we could not devise a movie that would be so bizarre, actually. The self-mortification, the mortification of the flesh in every way possible. And what Buddha's pointing out is that that's not the way. It's this poised, full stop in the woundness, as I would say it, of just sit quietly, you know, and then just get used to it. Then you can have an ordinary life in terms of an ordinary ascetic life. You don't need to have a fanatical ascetic life. Ordinary contemplative culture, not fanatical, extremist, self-mortification of the flesh ascetic culture. This actually undermines the progress. It actually undermines, it dissipates the intensity, it dissipates it. And Buddha put himself through these various practices, trying what works best. And he said, okay, in terms of asceticism, this sort of middle path of asceticism works best. Be simple, be quiet, be contemplative, but don't hang yourself upside down from a tree for 10 years, you know. Don't stick your hand into coals every day, hot coals every day, for 10 years. I can't even dream up this stuff. I mean, they dreamed up so much stuff. A bed of nails, for instance. You could still see those who do that. They spend every day lying on a bed of nails. Okay. Buddha said, no, you don't need to do that. Just sit comfortably, quietly, and recognize there's nothing, no need to sync up. There's no need to sync with reality at all. And gradually evaporate this continuity fear. And when you've done enough for the day, and you think, wow, it was very intense. Be simple, move quietly. Don't move gracefully, peacefully, quietly. Don't try to fixate on anything in particular, and just get used to it, get familiar with it. And then next day, practice more. Next day, practice more. This is the Dharma. This is the way. This is the path. This is universally, you know, true. What is being said here is what has always been said. Just using this particular terminology. Don't need these wild processions of crucifixion processions, people being put on crosses, flagellated, blood streaming down. You know, that's dissipating the intensity of the wow, which is the wow. I don't need any resume at all. I don't need that. I just see it dissipates it. So be simple, be humble, be meek. You don't need to be showing off some sort of bizarre asceticism you don't need to be standing in a freezing river, you know, all day for months and months at a time, or sitting on this barren rock, you know, saying, I'm just going to sit here in this posture for 20 years. No. So you can just be an ordinary citizen of this time, and sitting in your city or suburb or country, wherever you are, and every day you just go further towards the big time. And just be quiet, hold the intensity of a wow, I'm getting closer and closer to the big time, and you will succeed. You didn't ever have to hang yourself by hooks for 10 years. Like I hook yourself up to a tree limb for 10 years, hang there. So as the world builds their resume, you don't need the resume. This is the tough thing, you see. Everyone's building such a great resume, and I'm just sitting.